very recently amongst an old pile of manuscripts. It's the only known piece Vivaldi wrote for unaccompanied voices, and it's being sung for the very first time in public by the David Liani Choir. Vivaldi the composer is still a mystery. Researchers have begun to piece together his life story, and I've tried to find out what lies behind the music so that Antonio Vivaldi the man can emerge from the shadows as his music has done already. Antonio Vivaldi was born in Venice on March the 4th, 1678, during an earthquake. It was a premature birth, and the midwife, thinking the baby wouldn't survive, immediately baptized him. But he lived, and at 2 months old, his parents brought him here to their local church of San Giovanni for formal baptism.
300 years later, in the 1960s, a sharp-eyed researcher discovered an entry in the baptismal register of this church. The first recorded fact about Antonio Vivaldi of Venice. In translation, it reads, May the 6th, 1678, Antonio Lucio, son of Signor Gian Battista Vivaldi, musician, and of Signora Camilla, his wife, who was born on the last 4th of March, being in risk of death, was baptized at home by Margherita Veronese, midwife. Today, he was brought to this church, where he received the exorcisms and the very holy oils.
When Vivaldi was born, Venice was a rich port trading with Europe and the Middle East. It was established as an independent state and called by the Venetians La Serenissima, the most serene Republic of Venice. The city bustled with merchants, ambassadors and travelers from all nations, and everyone who came to Venice talked about the Venetian passion for music.
In Venice, I did hear the best music that I ever did in all my life. So good that I would willingly go 100 miles on foot at any time to hear the like.
In front of San Marco, a shoemaker or a smith, dressed in his work clothes, starts a tune. Other people of his sort join in with him and sing this song with accuracy, precision, and taste that is scarcely to be met with in fashionable society in our northern lands.
Ding, 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 dong.
So, as young Antonio Vivaldi grew up, he must have heard music all around him, in the city streets as well as at home.
Antonio, il del resto.
His father, Gian Battista Vivaldi, kept a barber shop and was known as Gian Battista Rosso, red-haired Gian Battista. Vivaldi's mother, Camilla, was a tailor's daughter. Vivaldi had 3 younger sisters and 3 younger brothers, though none of the others became musicians, and the brothers carried on the family shop. Though Tonio helped in the shop like any other Italian shopkeeper's son, he was much more interested in his father's second profession. As well as being a barber, Gian Battista was a musician, a violinist. And this was a good double, as most barber shops in Venice kept a few instruments so that customers could amuse themselves while they waited.
Tonio, dai Benedetto, sbrighiti col signor Rinaldo. Quanto te voglio?
Dai il mantello al signor Vaccari, dai.
Though he remained delicate all his life and was afflicted with asthma, Tonio was full of energy with an unbounded enthusiasm for music. As he grew older and stronger, Gian Battista taught him to play the violin. In 1675, Gian Battista had joined a musician's guild, a society of singers and instrumentalists who played together for their own pleasure and also for other people on professional engagements. The guild held meetings, rehearsals and concerts at the church of San Martino near the barber shop, and inside Appropriately enough, there was a chapel dedicated to Saint Cecilia, the patron saint of music.
E adesso sentili insieme, eh?
The leader of the musicians' guild, Signor Legrenzi, taught Tonio to play the organ and gave him lessons in musical theory.
Prova tu adesso.
Legrenzi was appointed director of music at San Marco. This was the greatest church in Venice, adorned with treasures that Venetians had brought back from all over the world. San Marco was famous for its music. The composers Monteverdi, Cavalli and Gabrielli had been music directors before Legrenzi, and he was determined to keep up the high standard. He enlarged the orchestra and brought in colleagues from the Musicians Guild, including Gianbattista Vivaldi. Tonio went along too and helped out doing odd jobs and sitting in at rehearsals. The church was the greatest patron of music in Venice. As Antonio grew up, delicate, passionately absorbed in music and used to working in churches, it was perhaps natural that he should offer himself for the priesthood. In 18th century Venice, it caused no surprise that a priest should continue with his musical career. And throughout the long period of training, Antonio continued with his playing and composing. Ten years later, in 1703, he was finally ordained priest. His official title now was Don Antonio Vivaldi, but because of his red hair, he was known for the rest of his life as Il Prete Rosso, the Red Priest. It is the duty of a priest to say Mass every day of his life, and for a while, Don Antonio complied with that rule. Then the asthma, which had dogged him all his life, flared up, and this was to affect his whole future.
Differunt bellum fidetio atque, quam bellum fit multitudine contra estraneos, sed multitudinis...
When I had been ordained priest, I said Mass for rather more than a year and then gave it up, because three times I had to leave the altar without finishing Mass on account of my illness. I shall never say Mass again, not because of a veto or a command, as His Eminence can confirm, but of my own accord, and this on account of the chest ailment I have suffered from since birth, which oppresses me greatly.
That was Vivaldi's explanation 25 years later. But there was a very different story. It was said that one day he was saying Mass, when suddenly he had a brilliant idea for a piece of music that he was composing. Afraid, in case he should forget it, he abandoned the service and the congregation and immediately raced off to the sacristy to write it down. Apparently the church authorities were so shocked that they forbade him ever to say Mass again. It's hard to know which version to believe. For instance, how could Vivaldi have spent 10 years training for the priesthood without discovering that saying Mass brought on his asthma? Then again, he might genuinely have been taken ill. But because his fanatical interest in music was well known, someone might easily have joked, oh, no way, he's off to compose some more music. And that's just the kind of comment which everyone would have believed. He always complained of ill health, but for the next 30 years, his life was filled with activity. And although he continued to wear priest's clothes, at 28 years of age, he was, in fact, a priest without a job.
Today, Venice is still a great port. For the last 800 years, the city has had a floating population of sailors, traders and foreigners, and for centuries there was a high illegitimacy rate. Because of frequent wars and shipping losses, there were many orphans, so much so that it was apparently common to see the corpses of abandoned babies thrown into the canals. To deal with this problem, foundling hospitals were set up, supported partly by the Republic of Venice and partly by their own efforts. One foundation, entirely for girls, was called the Ospedale della Pietà, near to St. Mark's. It was a religious foundation with its own church, where the orphan girls regularly gave fundraising concerts. For, along with their religious education, they were given musical training of a very high standard. In 1706, Don Antonio Vivaldi, once a priest and permanently a musician, was appointed music master to the Pietà, a post he was to hold for 30 years. He taught the violin and the viola, supervised other instruments, conducted the choir, composed music for the girls to play, and bought their instruments.
The transcendent music is that of the illegitimate and orphaned girls of the asylums. They sing like angels and play the violin, the flute, the organ, the oboe, the cello, and the bassoon. In short, there is no instrument, however unwieldy, that can frighten them.
No, no, più decise, più decise, più anima. Su, avanti, forza, avanti, di nuovo, su, su. Ecco, avanti.
These young ladies, thanks to the allurements of their singing and playing, praised by all the city and listened to with rapture, frequently attract the most respectable young men from whom they receive offers of marriage. Thus, many of them gain deserved riches.
Every Sunday and holy day, there's a performance of music by the young women who are set in a gallery and are hid from any distinct view of those below by a lattice of ironwork. Their performance is surprisingly good, and it is all the more amusing since their persons are half concealed from view.
I swear to you that there is nothing so diverting as the sight of a young and pretty nun in white habit, beating time and playing with all the grace and precision imaginable.
Sometimes they performed in other churches, or even in private houses, and the Red Priest with his line of girl musicians was a familiar sight in Venice. By the time he was 35, Vivaldi was at the heart of Venetian musical life. As well as his work with the Pietà, the San Marco Orchestra, and his composing, he also accepted private engagements as a violinist. Many of the Venetian nobility owned villas on the mainland, where they could ride, hunt, enjoy their gardens and their estates in a way that was not possible in Venice itself. Often, Vivaldi and his father were hired to play at these villas. Perhaps it was these surroundings that inspired Vivaldi to write some verses about life in the country. He set them to music, which he called The Four Seasons.
Thank you.
Antonio Vivaldi's reputation as a composer began to spread across Europe, and everywhere people wanted to buy his music.
In the past, my compositions have had, as well as their own shortcomings, the misfortune of bad publication. Today, their greatest advantage is to have been printed by the famous hand of Monsieur Estienne Roger.
Vivaldi was lucky with his publisher. Estienne Roger of Amsterdam had invented a new system of printing music, so that it was clear and easy to read. He also numbered and catalogued works so that they could be ordered by post from anywhere in Europe. By now, Vivaldi was making foreign tours as an honoured guest of royalty. But there were still worlds in Venice for him to conquer, and a new career was dawning for him, opera. Venice was then the operatic centre of Europe, with no less than 8 opera houses.
In 1714, when he was 36 years old, Vivaldi launched himself into the world of opera. He later claimed to have composed 94 operas in 25 years. But composing just wasn't enough for him. He wanted to control it. He wanted to be a big impresario. So he plunged headlong into this glamorous and exciting world, raising money, engaging singers, interviewing designers, costumiers and wig makers, and enjoying himself as never before. And though the world of opera was notoriously scandalous, corrupt and full of intrigue, the erstwhile priest took to it like a duck to water.
This was how he met Anna Giraud, the daughter of a French wig maker in Mantua. She was in her 20s, he was 43. He taught her singing and drama and wrote parts for her. In 1724, he launched her on an operatic career. Carlo Goldoni, a Venetian dramatist, observed them.
Don Antonio, the clergyman, an excellent violin player and a middling composer, had taught Anna Giraud and given her training in singing.
Bravo, 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 bravo.
She was not a beauty, but she had charms. A delicate figure, beautiful eyes, beautiful hair, a charming mouth. She did not have a beautiful voice, nor was she a great musician, but she had many charms. She acted well and had protectors. One needs nothing more to deserve the role of prima donna.
The opera for me is the new one at Sant'Angelo. The book is passable, if you forget reality. The music is Vivaldi's. He has brought out 3 operas in 3 months, and is very varied, from the sublime to the tender. His pupil, Anna Giraud, did wonders, in spite of her voice not being the greatest.
Vivaldi installed Anna in his own house, and the relationship lasted for the rest of his life. Anna's elder sister Paulina lived with them and helped to look after the domestic affairs. Both she and Vivaldi were immensely proud when Anna was praised by the critics.
Nina, sei splendido. Guarda questo giornale. La signorina Anna Giraud ha cantato e recitato con voce accattivante.
La sono vede.
Vivaldi always declared that whilst Anna was his pupil, Paulina was his housekeeper and nurse, for he still insisted that his health was very poor, in spite of the dynamic energy he needed to get through all his activities.
È tutto merito suo, maestro.
Anna was known all over Venice as l'amica del prete rosso, the red priest's friend, and she and Vivaldi went everywhere together. For 14 years, their life was varied and exciting. But much later on, there was criticism of Vivaldi's friendship with Anna and his style of living.
My travels have always been very costly to me because I've always had to make them with four or five persons to assist me. For 14 years we traveled around together, and everywhere in all the many European cities we went to, these two ladies were admired for their propriety. Rome for three carnival seasons for the opera. I played the violin in the opera house, and as is well known, His Holiness the Pope commanded me to play for him, and I received his profuse thanks. I was called to Vienna by the Emperor himself, and these same two ladies went with me. This is the truth, and all Europe knows it.
In Vienna, the Emperor Charles VI, a keen amateur musician, received him so warmly, his courtiers said he spoke more to Vivaldi in 2 weeks than to his ministers in 2 years. He gave Vivaldi money, a gold medal and chain, and made him a knight of the Holy Roman Empire. Vivaldi dedicated 10 concertos to him in grateful thanks for his magnanimous protection. With all his foreign travel, his dealings with royalty and the glamorous world of opera, Vivaldi still kept up his connection with the Pietà.
The administrators of the church and seminary require the Reverend Antonio Vivaldi to deliver 2 concerti every month when he is himself in Venice, and during the time of his absence, he is to send them by messenger, if this can be done without extra cost.
Whenever he returned to the Pietà, the girls were delighted to see him, to hear about his foreign travels, and to have him rehearse with them his latest composition written specially for them. If Vivaldi kept to his contract, he must have composed a further 400 concertos for the Pietà alone. This facility has made his critics say he composed one concerto 400 times, a charge his admirers fiercely deny.
He is an old fellow with a prodigious talent for composition. I have heard him boast of composing a concerto with all its parts in less time than it would take a copyist to copy it.
Not many statues in Venice, as Venetians have always believed that the city itself is worth celebrating far more than her individual citizens. One of the very few to be honored is Carlo Goldoni, Venice's greatest dramatist, who was 30 years younger than Vivaldi. When Vivaldi was already a world-famous impresario, Goldoni was a rather impertinent lawyer's clerk, eager to pick up the job of rewriting verses for one of Vivaldi's operas, in which Anna Giro was to sing.
I was sent to the musician's home to make the necessary changes in the opera to suit the wishes of the composer. I told him I was entrusted with making any alterations he required in the libretto. He did not answer, so I offered to come back again at another time, as I had no wish to disturb him in his religious pursuits. He was good enough to say my work gave him pleasure, and that I had a talent for poetry. But that did not mean I could write for music. I asked him to do me the honor of showing me the drama.
volo?
Sì, sì, volentiera. Adesso vado subito a vedere se lo trovo qua. Eccolo, dove arriva, dove si trova, non lo vedo. Romulus, Deus, 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 se non so di se qua. Dove si l'ondaggio? Era qua dove avevo messo. Romulus, Deus. Vediamo se lo trovo. Eccolo qua.
At last he found it, and I offered there and then to write the verses he needed. He pointed out that Signorina Giro disliked languid singing. She wanted a piece with expression and excitement. I said that I quite understood and realized that Signorina Giro's voice was not strong. He was highly indignant, so I hastened to agree with him that his pupil could sing anything.
Verbis completum, verbis completum, non c'è tutto spirito, perfetto di mente, sfondati, fammi
magistrati. While I scribbled some lines suitable for his purpose, he carried on saying his office for the day. And in less than quarter of an hour, I had written the text for an aria of 8 lines.
Ho finito, signor.
Ma è splendido questo! Sei veramente splendido! Anina! Anina! Vieni presto, vieni! Vieni, guarda qua! Guarda qua cosa che ha scritto sto signor! Tieni, lesi! E questo? Questo sei il signor che l'ha scritta in manco di un quarto...
He embraced me and swore he would never have another poet but me. He entrusted me with the drama and ordered me to make all the alterations. He was satisfied with everything I did, and the opera succeeded excellently.
Senz'altro, indubbiamente.
Many of his operas succeeded excellently and made his name and his fortune. But in the end, they were to cause his downfall. In 1737, when he was nearly 60, a patron of his, Count Bentivoglio, commanded him to put on 2 operas for a festival in Ferrara. Vivaldi plunged happily into the familiar routine and took care to keep his patron absolutely up to date in everything he was doing.
I am grateful that Your Excellency has not forgotten the promise you made in Rome to keep me always under your protection. We have assembled such a company. Ferrara has not and will not see its like in any of their carnival celebrations.
Sì, sì, sì. Sì, la sarà una buona parte partissi.
Ah, grazie, maestro. Don Antonio, che piace il vestito, vero? Ma non che vorrei anche più desolge.
Ah, sì, sì, la sei una principessa greca. Ande presto, 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 ande torna esolge tutto quello che potessi.
Every artist is experienced and full of talent. On my word of honor, Your Excellency must believe that he is well served. Signorina Giro sends her humble greetings, and as she will be offering her imperfections at Ferrara, begs you to take her under your protection as well.
The connection with Anna Giro was to be the ultimate cause of his ruin. Vivaldi had forgotten that Ferrara lay in the Papal States, directly ruled by the Church, and he himself was still a priest. His enemies in the jealous world of opera made use of this.
Circa i piani che voi avete fatto per la presentazione della vostra opera.
Your Excellency, Count Bentivoglio, after so much intrigue and all my hard work, my opera for Ferrara is wrecked. Today the Papal Nuncio ordered me, on behalf of His Eminence Cardinal Ruffo, not to go to Ferrara and do the opera, because I am a priest who doesn't say mass, and because of my friendship with the singer Giro.
Maestro. Per piacere, volga stare a scrivere.
After such a blow, Your Excellency can imagine how I feel. I have entered into 6,000 ducats worth of contracts over this opera.
Ma per cosa non mi vuole ascoltare, maestro?
I have already paid out 100 zecchini.
Di zecchini.
Ma se che dico che non me ne importa.
No, no.
It is impossible to put on the opera without Giro. It's impossible. It's not so easy to find such another prima donna.
Maestro, non me ne importa di andare a Ferrara. Troverò un altro cantante, maestro. Maestro!
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 I can't put on the opera without me. I have no wish to put this undertaking into other hands. But then again, I'm bound by my contracts. This is a sea of troubles. What upsets me most is the disgrace that His Eminence lays on these poor women, when no one in the world has dreamt of such a thing before. Every week they have performed the devotions, as can be checked by authenticated documents. It was 25 years ago that I said Mass for what will be the last time, on account of a chest ailment that has burdened me since birth. For 30 years I have been maestro at the Pietà, and without any scandal. This is the truth, and all Europe knows it. I appeal to the benevolence of Your Excellency and hope you will have the compassion to inform His Eminence Rufo of these facts, because this order will mean my absolute ruin. I recommend myself to my kind patron humbly.
But his kind patron could not or would not save him, and Vivaldi never recovered from this bitter blow. The mood of Venice had changed almost overnight. The city had begun its long decline, and Vivaldi was considered old-fashioned.
I have found, to my great astonishment, that he is not as esteemed as he merits in this country, where fashion is everything, where they have long heard his works, and where last year's music no longer counts.
Disillusioned and unhappy, Vivaldi took a desperate step. He left Venice and went to Vienna, where once the musical emperor Charles VI had been so good to him. But times had changed in Vienna too. The emperor had died, and there was no work for 63-year-old Vivaldi. Without his music, he hadn't the courage to fight his bad health. By July 1741, he'd become desperately ill with his asthma and could not move on elsewhere.
Ma quando sei che arriva sto dottore?
Ormai non vi c'è più niente da fare.
The priest Don Antonio Vivaldi, the incomparable violinist, known as the red-haired priest, highly esteemed for his concertos and other compositions, earned at one time more than 50,000 ducats, but because of his immoderate prodigality, died a pauper in Vienna.
After his death, Vivaldi and his music were forgotten for nearly 200 years. It's only in the last 30 years that his scores have been rediscovered and his music played again. And today, he's as popular as ever he was in his lifetime. And for thousands of people, Vivaldi's music is Venice. I think that would have pleased him very much indeed, because he was a man devoted to his native city. He once wrote an oratorio for the girls of the Pietà. It was called The Triumph of Judith and told the story of a heroine who frees her people. It was a tribute to the free city, La Serenissima, the most serene Republic of Venice.
Our only consolation is the renowned Republic of Venice, in which the freedom of Italy has been maintained from its foundation up to the present day. And may God uphold it till the end of time.